This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
Hello and welcome to Podcast Unlocked, episode 577. It is January 10th in 2023. I'm Marina Sanchez, hosting today for Ryan, who is out on business. But joining me, we have a full crew. As always, it is Stella here with me in the office. Welcome, Stella.
Hi.
Then we have joining us remotely is Taylor. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you. I'm at the office in spirit.
Yeah, yeah. As is Destin, whose room is also green, which is always really fun for me because I'm always just like, dang, you're basically here.
That's right. Bam. Hi, everybody.
Hey, welcome. So we're going to get right into it because we have so much news to talk about, which is great because last night when I was playing this show, there was nothing. So I was like, oh, great. Thank you guys for announcing everything before we recorded. Right before we get into it, though, I want to shout out our Wolong Finland Dynasty January IGN First. So if you are interested in Wolong, definitely check out the site. We have a lot going on as far as new gameplay, interviews, clips. So check those out. But like I said,
Wolong is one of my most anticipated titles. So
yeah, Destin, you must be loving
it. Yeah, yeah. The IGN First stuff is cool. We got to look at a few new areas, some of the new bosses. Mm-hmm. The coverage has been awesome. So
yeah, I really like that exclusive gameplay we had too. It was pretty,
yeah,
pretty neat. Also pretty neat though is your guys' predictions kind of were answered in that we're getting information like ASAP from Microsoft. So thank you, Xbox, for listening, obviously, to everyone saying, hey, can we get some
They listen to us.
Yeah, yes, specifically us.
Specifically.
It is really funny whenever people online will be like, they listened to what I said. It's like, I don't think so. But, you know, we all said this. And they're like, yeah, that makes sense. Which it does.
Phil was like, they're right. We got to ramp this up ASAP.
Oh my goodness. So that news in question is that we're getting Xbox's Developer Direct on January 25th. So last week I said you guys discussed how we needed some concrete details for 2023, and we are getting that very soon. So this is an extended gameplay showcase live stream that will feature gameplay and new details from Forza Motorsport from Turn 10. And then from Arkane Austin, we're going to have more gameplay and details on combat, customization, bosses, and the open world from Redfall. Also, some discussions on multiplayer. Very exciting for me. And then we'll also have more from Minecraft Legends, which is a game that I completely forgot exists and could not remember what it looked like, aside from it looking like Minecraft. That'll be at the show, too, from Mojang and Blackbird Interactive. It's noted in the Xbox Wire post that that is launching this spring, so that's really good. And then following that, they will have a full standalone showcase for ESO Chapter Reveal event, which is hosted by ZeniMax Online Studios, which will provide an in-depth details for ESO players. And that, I think, is really smart to keep as its own separate thing. In addition to announcing all of this, they said in the post to dedicate the proper amount of time for a deep dive into Bethesda Game Studios' Starfield, a standalone show is in the works. So a lot there, which is great because we needed some information. So Destin, I want to throw to you first. What do you think about this event?
It's great. They really, really needed to do something. I like that it's not going to be like hosted or have talent involved. It's really going to be the developers talking about the games that they've been working on. And that's really, really exciting. They knew that they couldn't announce this and not include the fact that there's going to be a separate Starfield event. People would have just been like, well, what's wrong with Starfield? Starfield's clearly in trouble. Like, uh-oh. But no, they're doing a whole separate event just to dive into Starfield. Miranda, there have been a lot of previews hitting for Redfall, and it has me much more interested in that game. I know you've been covering it a lot for IGN. Games Radar recently had an interview with Arkane Austin, and that was really cool because we learned just a little bit more about the world of Redfall. Looking forward to that, but I'm really excited about seeing more from Forza Motorsport. Staying on Redfall for just a second, I think they've done a really good job of showing the atmosphere building of that world and how you're going to be like discovering things. I don't think they've dove enough into the game mechanics in video form.
Yeah.
Like, I want to know about how the loot system is going to work and how it's more Borderlands than anything from what I've read and seen.
Right. They've What's tried your take to make on it. That? They've tried to make it very clear that this is not Left 4 Dead. They're like, no, like we've said it so many times since last year. And I think this is their opportunity to really show that, as you said, Dustin, they haven't shown a lot of like the moment to moment gameplay, a lot of clips, a lot of like, here's a cool little feature fighting like one vampire as we see here. This has been around for a while, but they haven't gone into like how multiplayer is going to work or like you said, loot systems. We talked a lot about in that interview. I sat down with Harvey Smith for like an hour and just like drilled him down on so many questions of mechanics and exactly how loot system works and all that multiplayer information that is really important when you're connecting online with somebody. But I think seeing it is a whole different thing. And that's what hopefully we'll get to see here. Stella, what stood out for you with this announcement?
I'm really excited for Redfall, but also like you said, like I know you got that interview and we got a lot of information, but it's been hard to visualize because upon first reaction, you're just like, oh, it looks like Back 4 Blood. Like the graphics look this similar and the way that you're not completely ADSing all the time, it's very similar too. So you're just like, it's really hard to visualize what this is going to play like. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited for that. I am really glad that they are separating the Starfield presentation from this other extended gameplay showcase because I know that people would just probably be like, where's Starfield, Starfield, Starfield? So it's nice that they are separating it. I'm honestly really excited for Minecraft Legends. It looks really fun. And I really liked Minecraft Dungeons. So another multiplayer game that we can play seems really fun. And we didn't really get a lot about that. Like you said, you forgot what it looked like.
Yeah, so I was like, okay, well, when I first saw it, I was like, oh, it's like Minecraft Dungeons. I'm like, well, not really, because it does have its own like visual style. It's the camera's pulled back more. And so it was hard for me to like think of what it was immediately because it was so fast, I think, amidst everything else that's been going on.
Yeah, so I'm really excited about that, which, I mean, I don't know. Minecraft is just such a classic game, and the fact that they've been able to branch out recently is really cool. So I'm really excited to see what comes out of that.
Right. Taylor, what do you think?
Well, first off, I'm really glad that they addressed that Starfield wasn't going to be there because when I read the press release, I was like, hold up, for Starfield? and then I kept reading, and they're like, oh, well, it's actually going to have its own presentation. And I'm glad they did address that because I felt like if they just said nothing about it and then just waited till later to say something like towards like maybe the end of the stream or something, I think people would have been upset about that. But I'm excited to learn more about Redfall. I think I want to learn more about the abilities that they're going to have. And hopefully they'll give us a firm release date because it's been delayed, what, once, twice already? So I want to play this. I want to play this game. Give us a release date, please.
Yeah, we got the first delay. And I think on your note there too, Taylor, is we don't have a lot of release windows aside from that initial from 1 year from last showcase.
Dustin smirking. Dustin smirking.
I hit my mic and it like went flying across the thing. Oh, so I was laughing.
I thought you were laughing about the lack of release dates. I was like, yeah, I mean.
No. So do you guys think we're going to get firm release dates for these games? Obviously, they also mentioned that Forza is going to be there. So we have like three really big things here.
I think we should. For some, I think we definitely should. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we do, and just on the Forza note real quick, if I can, it's actually one of the games that I'm the most excited about. Oh. Gran Turismo 7 kind of dominated the racing scene last year for PlayStation. In terms of sim racers, Forza Motorsport is really, they say they're trying to make the most technically advanced Forza ever made. So they're doing stuff like dynamic time of day and weather, and that's going to affect the temperature on the track. There's more points of contact with the tires. They're finally having fuel management in the game. They're adding different types of tires so that you can have different types of grips given the weather conditions. They're doing a lot since Forza Motorsport 7 to improve this one. We know about a few of the tracks that have been revealed thus far. I think during the GDC talk, they said there's something like 30 tracks, and then, you know, they'll do those with different routes and backwards and forwards and all that good stuff. But like Laguna Seca is going to be there. Hakone Kyalami Circuit de Spa. I don't know these names. Circuit de Spa Franco Chumps. And Maple Valley was one of the first ones they revealed. There's a lot going into this game, including in-game ray tracing, which was something that Gran Turismo really skirted around pre-launch. And then Forza is like, oh yeah, we're gonna have ray tracing in-game during races, as well as damage that's very specific about where the damage happens. Mm-hmm. There's a lot that we know about this game, and they've only shown just a little bit of it. I want to just see a race play out from start to finish. Like, they've talked about the technical aspects and how they're trying to really push the Forza engine forward with Forza Motorsport, and I want to see what the actual moment-to-moment gameplay is going to look like. I played through the campaign of Gran Turismo 7 last year. I'm ready for my next sim racer, and Forza Motorsport is definitely on that list.
I think you really hit the nail on the head there too, Dustin, when saying that you want to see more of this too, because the whole, I think, idea of this showcase is it's supposed to be, as it's titled, a developer direct, but it's very much about the gameplay. It's about getting into these games and not having a lot of talking heads, I think, I hope. Mm-hmm. going through it.
We've seen the flash and sizzle. We're looking at it right now in B-roll if you're watching. And now I just want to see a race.
Exactly.
I want to see Redfall. I want to see somebody play through that, get a piece of loot, dismantle their old weapon, and equip the new one. What are the different perks like? Because they've talked about that in the interview. And with Forza, I want to see, what does a race look like? What does it look like when you do a pit stop and have to change your tires out because it started raining or something? You know, what does that dynamic damage look like in-game? During a traditional race. So right. I'm really excited to see more from those two properties and like whatever they're doing with ESO and Minecraft.
Yeah, I would say too, like weirdly with the pandemic, I think we've really missed that like preview press beat in a way. Yeah. And it's kind of starting to come back and it sort of existed mm-hmm. over that time. But without that, we haven't had as much just like direct gameplay capture from outlets like us or anywhere else or even from the studios directly either. And so I think we're just in a way hungry for that visual information. It's like, yes, we've heard people talk about these things. We just want to see them in action. And mm-hmm. I completely agree with that, Dustin. But also what you said about there being fuel management made me more certain than ever that I'm a Horizon person.
I was like, thinking the same thing.
Oh, no.
I was like, oh, this is a lot. The road temperature.
It's the sim.
No, yeah, absolutely.
It's a sim, so it's a different experience than Horizon, for sure.
Absolutely, and I think it's so cool to see them getting into that sort of depth with how they're doing the simulation part of it, and I think it'll be really fun for the folks who want to get down and dirty, get their wheels out, you know, sit down. You know,
that's right.
Put your little suit on. I don't know, like, if I were doing this, I would absolutely, like, get gear. I'm like, all right, we're going in. But, you know, like, people build up full setups like that.
They do. It's really cool. Yeah.
I admire that.
Who would do that?
Dustin prepping, has a suit in the closet already.
I do have the steering wheel and stick shift and so like a mount for it. Bought it for GT, and now when I play Forza on PC, I can use it on PC also.
Yay!
So.
Now that's we just so gotta fun. Get you like a cool chair. I will say that.
No.
That's like the best part about going to arcades. Wait, but that's the best part of going to arcades. Like, you have that full setup, so you don't have to buy it. But like, I think arcades don't have Forza Motorsport. Like, that's a lesser experience at that point. Also, they probably
Fanatec wants to give me a call on behalf of IGN. They can give me a call. They're the premier creator of sort of stuff. So yeah,
excellent.
They do make really good stuff.
Yeah,
in that department, they're very consistent about.
Don't
that.
Call Taylor. Just test it.
Okay, so. Hopeful for release dates for these. Obviously, Minecraft seems best positioned for it, as they did say, like, coming this spring in the post, so they're probably going to give some more details for that. I would assume, too, that since they're giving so much information, that these are pretty close. But are you guys worried that Starfield is not? Do you think that's going to get pushed out of this original window because it's not going to be at this event?
No.
No?
Not personally.
I don't think
I talked a lot, so if anybody else wants to jump in before I do. I think it's staying. They just published like 2-3 days ago that it's still coming out the first half of 2023. Mm-hmm. So I think it stays.
All right.
Yeah. I don't know if we'll get a release date specifically, but yeah, they did announce that they're not going to have any more delays. So hopefully they stick to that. So I don't think that it's going to get delayed. I think especially with this having its own showcase, I feel like there's enough there that they're like, yeah, we're like on our last legs. We just need to make sure everything's polished. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what it feels like to me with that messaging. But yeah.
Taylor, I want to go to you for this next question. But what do you think about this potentially being a reoccurring event for Microsoft and having developer directs? And do you have any potential wishlist studios that you'd like to see do this next?
Well, I'm actually pretty excited about this. I hope they continue to do this in the future, especially since, what was it, 2020? They announced a lot of first-party games that were, like, down the pipeline, and we haven't really heard from a lot of those. Like, I would like to know what's going on with State of Decay 3, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I hope that this, they just knock it out of the park, and then that's their sign to go, maybe we should do more of these. Because I feel like there's just been this wide gap of just, like, radio silence. And, like, I know these games are coming, but maintaining a reasonable line of communication does go a long way.
Yeah, absolutely. Destin, is there any studios from Microsoft that you want to see specifically do this?
Well, to Taylor's point, they have been waiting. If there was one studio I were to pick, just more from Bethesda, like what's id working on, what's going on with Avowed from Obsidian, I believe, right? That's like by far the most anticipated Xbox game. So if I could pick one, it's Avowed. But I feel like Microsoft's been waiting for whatever's going to happen with Activision to happen. And right. I think they're hoping that that's done by E3 time so that they can have a big presence at E3. But to answer your specific question, this clip of Avowed is all we have. We know it's in the Pillars of Eternity universe. I want more Avowed, please.
Fair, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is there anything on your list, Stella, that you'd like to see?
Not really. I mean, just more release dates, honestly. Yeah. Because, like, I don't know what to expect, so I'm just, like, I've stopped expecting things, right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, I'm good with the stuff that they're showing at the Gameplay Showcase. We're probably getting release dates there. But, yeah, no, like, I don't have a tie to Avowed. Like, I don't have anything with that. Perfect Dark seemed really cool, but, like, we haven't gotten any updates on that either, so I don't know. That'd be kind of cool to get an update this year, but I know that they've gone through like a huge rework. So yeah, not really expecting anything for a while.
Right. I kind of hope that they use this as sort of a springboard for deep dives into games they say announce at like E3
yeah.
or at Gamescom, if there's any sort of, like, short showcases, because they always do these big reels, right? Mm-hmm. And I think this would also be a great place to just like pepper in, again, those deep dives yeah. and not necessarily do it like right after a show, because I think a lot of people have to like leave, and they did that sometimes. I think it was a Gamescom. Yeah. They had like a very long, like, hour and a half show. We're like, all right, guys, we gotta go.
I don't remember that, but yeah.
Yeah, like they just kind of drag on. And I think having more focused showcases that are shorter and ready to go would be a bit better, because yeah. if there's only a handful of games, then at least you have better expectations for what you're going to see, and the people that really care about it can tune in. Like I said with ESO, right? Like, I think that deserves a place too. And like, obviously there's people who are really excited about that, and giving them space to have that is really important.
Yeah.
But overall, we will see what they have for January 25th. Obviously we have our expectations set, which is always nice to have, just ready to go in, waiting for new information. So I'm excited, and I'm excited to watch it with all of y'all, because I'm sure we will be. But next up, we have more news. So I'm a little hesitant about release dates and anything basically these days. And here's another reason why. Ubisoft just delayed this morning Skull and Bones for the sixth time and canceled three other games. So this kind of comes off the heels of doing some investor calls, and they announced in a press release that they have delayed Skull and Bones once again. It was originally supposed to be out in fall 2018. It was last delayed in September to this March 9th, and now it's going to be sometime between April 2023 and sometime in 2024. Mm-hmm. No idea when. So it's got quite a big gap of just, it could be sooner, it could be later. Who knows what's up with that game? I'm convinced it's fake, but obviously, people have played it, and yeah. there is something very wrong going with it. And I just wish that team the best, because I cannot imagine how stressful today is for them and having to say, like, all right, we're getting in again, like, delayed again.
Yeah.
So the press release from Ubisoft said they are facing major challenges as the industry continues to shift toward mega brands and long lasting titles rather than that can reach players across the globe, across platforms and business models. They cited underperformance from Mario and Rabbids, Sparks of Hope, and Just Dance 2023 as issues. So in addition to, of course, delaying Skull and Bones, they also canceled three unannounced titles, which is always a bummer to see that happen. But those join Ghost Recon Frontline and Splinter Cell VR and two other unannounced titles that were canceled last July. So Ubisoft will also be doing some restructuring amid all of this news. In all of that, they also tried to say that they still have a lot of games coming out, of course. Avatar, Frontiers of Pandora, Assassin's Creed Mirage, and Quote, other premium unannounced games, including a large one, are on the way. So, yeah, obviously Ubisoft is pretty ambitious. They develop a lot of things, yeah. And the games that they put out are massive. Like, what was it? Assassin's Creed Valhalla just got its last update. That's been going on for a long time. Stella, what do you think about this news?
The part in the release where it says Ubisoft is facing major challenges as the industry continues to shift towards mega brands and long-lasting titles, it kind of brings up that point that I continually make about Ubisoft in recent years, is that I feel like they're just not in touch with what the community wants in terms of games. Like, yeah, they release a lot of games. Assassin's Creed always does really well. So, mm-hmm. Of course, it's a Call of Duty in terms of like open world action RPG games. Like, of course, it's going to do really well. But in terms of the other things that they've tried, they've not done well. And I think it's also a lot to do with the way that they do like closed groups, group studies to see how people like things. But they keep it very small. And it seems like the criticism that they take and the feedback that they're given, it's not really applied. So a lot of things like Hyperscape had a lot of issues, and it could have been a really decent BR that could have been long lasting. I mean, they just weren't able to adapt to their battle pass. They weren't able to adapt to their gunplay to be on par with everything else. And they just never made updates to it that made it come up to recent standards. And then they had to close that down. I know they had other FPS games that also did not match up to current day standards. And it just feels like there's this disconnect between where Ubisoft is and with what people want. Mm-hmm. So it's very interesting. I mean, Mario plus Rabbids, of course, it'll do well. Like, it's a good game. But I don't know if there was a real want for that currently. I know you don't like it, but, you know, I don't know if there was, like, a real want for that. And Just Dance, of course, will do decently among family and stuff. But ever since they got rid of the Kinect support and camera support, really, on other consoles, it's just not doing as well. And they also got rid of their esports for that, which was a huge scene. And now people are like, well, I don't want to play it anymore. Mm. So there's a lot of, like, disconnect that I feel like they have between their community and their actual development.
I would say, too, like, the Just Dance model of, like, distributing songs and stuff has been a little...
It's fine. You
unfavorable.
You buy it once, and they have a season pass now, but it is not... It's honestly not worth it.
No, like, I purchased it, I think, like, 2 years ago, and I was like...
It's not worth it. Yeah.
Don't love this. So I think there's just, as you're saying, they have a lot of challenges adapting to industry standards and then also just, like, paying attention to what's happening within the gaming scene. Taylor, what do you think?
Well, firstly, I feel that... I don't know. I feel like Ubisoft's starting to play it a little safer than they were, like, maybe 5-10 years ago. That big unannounced project, I'm thinking, I wonder if it's that Star Wars project that they unofficially announced but never really officially revealed. And I when they said the very broad release window for Skull and Bones, I just looked at it, I was like, we're not getting this year. I don't think we're getting it in 2023. But also, the other thing that kind of makes me cautiously optimistic about Ubisoft's future is that this focus on, like, these big, you know, IPs and things like that. But one of the things that I have an issue with, specifically in their open world games, is that I feel they focus more on the quantity over the quality. And I noticed this very apparently in the last two Far Cry games that I played. No, actually the last three. And I've noticed this was an issue in The Division 2 and pretty much every other Ubisoft open world game I've played in the last, like, 2 to 3 years. So if they're going to pivot to focusing more on things that aren't going to be much of risk takers, then I would hope that they also try to focus more on, less on, like, the scope and the big grand scale, and focus more on, like, giving us meaningful, like, side quests and things that actually make an impact and aren't just necessarily, like, radiant fetch quests or things of that nature.
Right. Dustin, what do you think before you have to head out here soon?
Yeah, I might have to bounce a little early, but real quick, I'm actually kind of excited about Skull and Bones. I have been for a while. They've had hands-on demos, and every time people walk away positive, excited about that property, and it looks interesting to me, and they delayed it again. I'm like, at some point, you either have to pull the plug or let that game release and just see what happens with it, you know? Don't tease us with, like, a 20-minute gameplay demo or however long that video was, the deep dive, and then just push it a year. It might be 2024 now. I don't know if that game's ever going to see the light of day.
Esteem and, like, excitement for that game is waning as it keeps getting pushed? Like, do you think it can hold up when it releases?
Yeah, I don't know. I've never seen a game that's been, like, done this many times and then delayed. It's very strange, you know? they have other properties too, like I'm just looking on Wikipedia. They have like Brothers in Arms. They have the Far Cry franchise. They still have a Splinter Cell that's being developed. Beyond Good and Evil, we just don't know what's happening with that.
Yep, Beyond Good
and Evil. Yeah, and like, like that must be in development hell. I don't know what's going on with that. And then like you look at some of the stuff that they've announced. They've announced like Prince of Persia, but then it has this strange new aesthetic that just doesn't resonate with people. I'm like, how do you not get that right? Like, how do you not recognize right away? People just want a prettier version of the original game. Dead Space nailed it. Like, look at Dead Space. Everybody's stoked for the new Dead Space. They changed just enough. They modernized it in a cool new engine. It looks great. People are stoked for that. Prince of Persia, it almost feels like you're getting a downgraded version of that original property. So, like, even with their remasters, the visual aesthetic just isn't there. So, it's... And then, Stella, like, all those shooters that you've covered from Ubisoft... What was X Defiant? Who was the target audience for that?
We keep talking about this. It was bad. It was like Overwatch, but if you took in like Division mechanics, and it did not translate well, and it just felt so bad. It was so bad. I'm so sorry.
They have great properties. Division, the Division team, massive. They're working on the Star Wars game. That's exciting. We haven't heard anything about it except for the screenshot that they're still working on it. You know, the Avatar game is still in development with the new engine. There's cool stuff happening. And Rainbow Six continues to just bring in money for them. Mm-hmm. And then they try these, like I'm all for new IPs and experiments, but I could have told you on paper that X Defiant didn't sound like a good idea.
So that's the thing that's very strange, right? Because it feels like Ubisoft is disconnected in a lot of ways. And I know I said this on a previous episode too, but it seems like they're more focused on chasing trends rather than trying to set them or rather than trying to play to their strengths. Like, obviously, they are one of the companies that have mega brands and like these ongoing games. And it's weird that they cited it. It's like, oh, obviously people just want these long-lasting titles and mega brands. And it's like, that's not entirely true. And I think they've also published some smaller games that have done really, really well. Mm-hmm. So it almost feels like they're not looking hard enough at what does well for them and trying more within that space. And they're just trying to capture like what's like the trendy buzzword. But then because you're starting off the buzzword and not starting before that even really became a thing, which is hard to do, right? You're like predicting the future of like what these trends could be. But because you're following it, you're going to come out years too late when that community that was really interested in that sort of game is already invested in a game. And it's really hard to shift off of that. Like when you come to Battle Royale or whatever it may be, it's hard to want to shift, especially if you've already put a lot of money in or if your friends are already there. And it has to be something cool and exciting. And it seems a lot of times like Ubisoft just makes these, they put them out real quick and they say, cool, we did it. And people are like, you have stated many times, Stella, I think it's just a little bit questionable of like, what is this battle pass? Like, why is this structured this way? Why didn't they do more research on how to make this
happen? We just want you to care about what you're making. And it's very obvious when like there's no passion there and it's just to try to match the trend that you're making. And it's so, so obvious. So what was that one where they were trying to make the, is it Splinter or no, Ghost Recon Frontline? Was that the Battle Royale thing too?
Yeah. Yeah, they're doing the Battle Royale for Ghost Recon, and it's just like Ghost Recon is a potentially multiplayer tactical shooter game, and you're just making a Battle Royale out of it, which might work, it might not, but it was very strange and out of left field, right?
Yeah, good that they canceled it. I mean, not good that they canceled it, but they did end up canceling it.
Yeah.
Did they?
Yeah.
I didn't know that was canceled, but like, there, so that one's gone. But like Ghost Recon, like go back to Advanced Warfare and like what that was about. That was the last popular one that did really well. And they haven't done anything like that basically since Gra 2. And it's like, how do you get so like off the path with a franchise like that? Like your fans have told you what they want. They like Gra and they like Gra 2. And then it's never sort of hit the way it did back then. And I don't know. It's frustrating because they have great IPs. And so I would make one argument. I don't think it's a lack of passion. I think it's too many cooks in the kitchen trying to get their vision on the table for a property, and that's how you end up with something like X Defiant with five different IPs crammed into it. It's just bizarre.
Right. And I think it's, as you said, too, it's a lot of people having a say on like what these things need to be. And it's not going to always be the people who are like, you know, making the game that chose these things. It's like, well, this is our assignment.
Yeah.
Now we got to try to do it under like whatever time constraints. And I think that the thing is, right, they have so many resources, obviously, that it'd be really interesting to see what happens if they, you know, focus them a little bit more on maybe trying those cool things and like letting some of their creativity show. And I think you get to see that with Assassin's Creed and other things every now and then. But it's like these auxiliary games they try to do that are outside of like their mega blockbuster hits that they have some troubles with. Taylor, did you have anything else?
Real quick, I have to go to the dentist though, so I'll just say goodbye to everybody. We got started a little late today, so my dentist appointment came up to it, but I'll see you next episode, everybody. Bye for now.
Yep. See you, Dustin.
So I guess we're trying to piggyback off of just these properties that they have. I, for one, would like another Rainbow Six game. I know that Siege is making them lots of money, but I'd like another story-driven Rainbow Six game. Like I remember when Patriots got canceled, for example, and that really broke my heart. So I just feel that they have a lot of great properties, as Destin was saying earlier. And I think that they should make another story-driven Rainbow Six game. I remember when they canceled Patriots and that ended up being Siege. I would still like to see Patriots. I know it probably won't be what it was, what, like 10 years ago when it was initially announced, but that's a game I would like to see again because I feel like, you know, the Tom Clancy properties, I like the Tom Clancy books. There's a lot of potential there to tell these very original and interesting stories, and we've seen them do this with other stuff. I mean, The Division had the potential, but I don't think they really tapped into that. I know that wasn't necessarily like a Tom Clancy book they adapted or anything like that, but I feel that Ubisoft really needs to kind of refocus more and on what makes their games great and looking back at their previous portfolio. And also, just like on another topic, I would like to see them make another horror game. Does anyone remember that game Cold Fear that came out during the sixth generation? I feel like someone in the comments, if you have seen, like, played Cold Fear or know what it is, please put that in the comments.
Someone out there is very excited that you said that title.
I hope they are, because I've really enjoyed it. I know a lot of people have, I think when it first released, a lot of people criticized it as being like a Resident Evil 4 clone, but if I recall, this game came out before Resident Evil 4 or something like that. Basically, the turnaround time, I was like, there's just no way that this developer coincidentally made a game that was a Resident Evil 4 clone or anything like that. And, you know, it's got a little jank to it, but I enjoyed it.
The
and
dev
I,
interview just... with the flashing lights is so funny.
It's really good.
So, Ubisoft, I think you should make another horror game. Why not remake Cold Fear? I don't know. I feel like there is a market to bring back big budget horror games that are actually scary and not just like ones that rely on jump scares or a lot of action. So that's my pitch.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, horror always has a place, I think, in the indie scene, but it's really having a moment in some of these bigger studios. I think everyone's kind of having that craving for something that's a little spooky. We also saw like Dead Space is coming out soon. There's a lot of excitement for that. We had a lot last year as well. So I think you're right on it with it, Taylor, that they should probably maybe look at their backlog. If they do want something that's established and not take a risk on a brand new IP, they could try something that they have in their back pocket.
Yeah.
But it remains to be seen what Ubisoft will do next. But, you know, hopefully the upcoming games will be cool. And I have hope that their Assassin's Creed games will continue to be good and fun. But hopefully they can get everything else in order. So for our next story, we have a shakeup at Playground Games. So six Forza Horizon developers depart Playground Games to form a new studio. So this is reported by Eurogamer that their creative director, Mike Brown, and five others have departed to make a studio called Maverick Games, with Brown as the lead. They're planning to work on premium open world games for consoles and PC. And from Eurogamer, they said Tom Butcher, a lead producer at Playground, serves as a studio executive producer. Matt Craven, a technical director at Playground, is the chief technical officer. Gareth Harwood is a technical art director, or was a technical art director at Playground, and is going to be their content director. Then Fraser Strachan, it was an audio director and will also be an audio director at Maverick. As does Ben Penrose will also be a person at Maverick. He was a former Playground art director as well. So they've got a lot of directors leaving.
Yeah.
To go do their own thing, which, you know what? that happens. And I think there was some speculation too of like people saying, hey, what happened at Playground? Like, what's wrong? How could they let this happen? And like, the reality of it is that sometimes people just leave to do their own thing. And like, sometimes you know, you work on an IP for so long. And I think Playground 2 is known for just doing Forza Horizon. Of course, they have some other things on the way. Fable someday, but you know, someday. But like, with that being said, if your studio is so focused on one thing, I think creatively that sort of limits you, right? Because you can't just start making a completely new game. So maybe this team just like really likes each other and they want to go do their own thing. And I think that's always exciting. We do have a lot of these smaller studios breaking out over the past few years, with these bigger studios having talent to come out and do their own things as well. So I'm curious to see what they'll be doing. They said, for players, we're already at work on exciting ultra high quality title, and for developers, we're building a home where everyone is encouraged to take risks, be curious, be creative, be innovative, be themselves, and above all, be a maverick, the developer said. Do you guys have any hopes of what they will work on first? Obviously, Forza Horizon's the big thing that they have now screaming across their resume, but they've worked on other things too. So is there anything else that you'd like to see them, or do you think they'll stick with racing games, or do you think they'll do something else?
I don't know. Why did they use the word maverick? It makes me think maybe they're gonna do some like Top Gun world game.
I know. It's like they're gonna make like flight sim DLC or something.
Like an arcade flight simulator. But yeah, I don't know. Immediately, as soon as I heard the word maverick, I was like, Top Gun? But
honestly, that's what I thought too. Because they went with Maverick Games, which I think has a lot of associations. Like, I also think of like the Mavericks, like sports.
Yes.
So I was like, wow, man, now it's like just really hard to associate with one thing. But I mean, it could be anything, right? They could be sticking with what they know and doing cars, but they could also do something with, as you said, flight. Like, I think there's maybe some space too, not necessarily as a simulator, but like some like dog fighting and like wild sky games.
I mean, I don't know. I have no idea. They have not given much information other than premium open world game. So I'm like, okay, it's for consoles and PC. So that seems like it's a very general audience. It doesn't seem to be competitive. It's very like for everyone, it seems. So I'm like, I don't know. I genuinely have no idea what they would make, but I know that their open world is going to be good because Forza Horizon 5 was amazing, and I don't like racing games. And I know this is not a racing sim specifically, but it was still so good, and I don't play any car-based games. So I fully trust that their open world is going to be good.
Okay. Yeah. Taylor?
Yeah, I mean, just to Stella's point, it's a very general, just like, hey, we're working on this thing. I'm excited for them. I'm curious to see exactly what the genre will be. I don't think it'll be a racing game, although if it is, I'd be impressed to see what they do and like kind of like some of the pages they've taken from working on the Horizon games.
Thank you.
But yeah, I'd like to see them do like a aerial combat game, or, you know, maybe do a platformer. I really like platformers. We need more platformers. Give us more platformers.
Yeah, that could always be a thing. It's curious to me that they're breaking off and immediately saying we're doing open world, because that's really ambitious to me. Open world's hard, but they do already have funding for their studio, so they're good to go there. They're doing a lot of hiring. They've already hired a few people. So they've got something going, and obviously they have an idea that they're obviously not ready to share, but it's cool that they do have something set up and ready to go. Also, Maverick also means independent individual who does not go along with a group or a party. Mm-hmm. That is from Merriam-Webster. Thank you, the dictionary. And so I think that also gives some idea. Like, obviously, it's probably not Top Gun.
I mean,
but
yeah,
you know, just
I can dream though.
Yeah. Just some like weird timing, I think, with that being kind of like talk of the town last year. But I think them trying to show that they want to do something independently and something different is going to be good. But I think it would also behoove them to say like what kind of open world game they want to do. Like, are you sticking with vehicle based things, or are you just kind of doing like more people based things, like just little people, you know? I mean, technically, if you're in a vehicle, there's someone in there, but also, do you ever pretend that you're the car when you're playing these games?
When I play Forza, I'm the car.
I'm
the car.
It's me, the car.
I feel like I'm in those Pixar movie Cars.
Yeah, exactly.
What if they do a Cars open world?
What if they're Lightning McQueen?
It's a
like that.
Ciao. This is,
oh my God. This is part of the thing that always happens for new studios too, I think, whenever you have them breaking out from a very established, very known studio that's identified. Oh my gosh, here we go. Ciao. When we have something identified with a franchise, it's hard to like see them splitting off and do something completely different until they say otherwise, basically. Mm-hmm. And I think that's actually been true for a lot of the smaller studios that I've seen. Like some people I remember were from Irrational or had at least worked on BioShock and did something that felt in that vein. And
yeah,
so that happens a lot, and that's not bad. It's just, I think we're looking for expectations because we're all hungry for knowledge and information that is not ours to have. And we are nosy. We want to know. So hopefully they'll say a little bit more eventually, but
yeah.
This is also a nice reminder for me to keep up my list of all these studios that broke up from big studios, and we want to know what they're doing next. So,
and also, if you guys haven't seen Cars, go watch Cars.
Ka-chow. Okay, let's go work. Let's go to the next story, because I think we're getting close on time. And this one's a little bit on the longer side. This one came from Taylor. And also nice news from Xbox this morning was that Xbox update aims to help consoles owners reduce carbon emissions. So this may be not the most exciting news for everybody, but it is actually pretty important. So every little bit helps is what I say. But Xbox insiders are getting access to a new feature today for Xbox Series consoles and the Xbox One consoles that change how their Xbox uses power when it's turned off. So when you turn off your console, you just press the button, you're like, okay, yes, shut down. Mm-hmm. That doesn't actually turn it off. So, and if you didn't know, I'm sure a lot of people know, it actually just goes into a sleep state. And so this allows it to perform updates. It allows you to say, hey, I want to buy this game and download it. Or on Game Pass, if you're on the app, you say, I want this game, add it to my library, let's download it. It lets you just do all these different functions while it's technically off, but not really. And in light of that, Microsoft just says, hey, what if we develop a new way to make sure that we're optimizing that time off to make a energy saving power option? And so this is from Xbox Wire. When your console is plugged in, connected to the internet, and regional carbon intensity data is available, Xbox will schedule game, app, and OS updates for your console at specific times during the nightly maintenance window that may result in lower carbon emissions because a higher proportion of electricity is coming from lower carbon sources on the electric grid. For example, instead of your Xbox waking up during the nightly maintenance window at a random time between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m., your console will wake up at a time when it can use the most renewable energy in your local energy grid. This decreases fossil fuel dependency and CO2 emissions and could potentially save you money. We love that. While only available to Xbox insiders that use shutdown energy saving right now, all Xbox gamers will have a chance to update soon so that your Xbox console is carbon aware, which is a funny term to say. It's like, we're carbon aware now. So this new option supposedly cuts power by up to 20 times compared to the normal sleep mode. The post also noted that this new option won't affect performance, gameplay, or console's ability to update games or the system. That goes on to say, also, every small step we take has a larger collective impact, and choosing shutdown energy saving can have a real meaningful impact. For example, for every two consoles that switch to shutdown energy saving mode for 1 year, we will save the equivalent amount of carbon removed by one tree planted and grown for a decade. This is based on average of the Xbox Series X and S and Xbox One consoles on shutdown energy saving mode for 20 hours per day for 1 year. So this is also going to be launch aside a thing where you can choose your active hours for Xbox. So it'll actually shut down outside of those hours. So this is on Xbox Series. They said you can just like set those hours. It's like, I play here, and then it'll adapt to your play time. So it's like, I'll be on and like awake. I don't know. For me, this feels more like it's like more sentient. It's like, it's my little buddy. It's awake. It wakes up when I wake up, because that's when I go play my Xbox. And it's like, all right, I'm going to sleep now. And then for the Xbox Ones, which it's nice that they're also supporting this on Xbox One. That's something you actually have to set, and it won't just automatically learn that. But yeah, so a lot of things to kind of address, obviously, global warming and trying to be a little bit more carbon aware, as they say. But Taylor, what did you think about this? Obviously, you brought the story forward, and it is pretty important.
I was very excited about it. I feel that Microsoft, just as a whole company, not just its gaming arm, mm-hmm. they've been a lot more environmentally conscious, as I like to say, because saying the carbon one just sounds kind of funny.
Carbon aware.
But carbon aware. I've noticed that in the last like 5 years that Microsoft has been a lot more environmentally conscious in some of their decisions, and especially just like on their like Surface products and just like the more of their bigger tech arm. So I'm glad to see that it's starting to show and appear more on the Xbox front. And I believe they, what was it, in 2019, Microsoft joined like the Playing for the Planet Alliance mm-hmm. in 2019. And also, I feel like it's just not a topic that's really talked about a lot in gaming, is that, you know, e-waste and just like carbon emissions and things like that, that stuff does leave a pretty big carbon footprint. So the fact that, you know, Xbox is taking the initiative to try to, you know, minimize the carbon footprint for its Xbox, like for console owners that have their consoles, I think is a really good step. And like, I know a lot of people think it's just like a small thing, but I was like, those little small things do add up if you, you know, if you take the initiative and actually partake in them.
Right. Stella, do you have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, this is honestly really nice. Also, it kind of also helps the user. So I know for PG&E in California area, there's like between the times like 4 and 8 p.m. or something, like it's the high time. So the fact that this also operates around, like it intuitively knows when the best time is to use your energy, which is great. So it's not only helping the environment, it's also helping you save a little bit of money on your electric bill, which is great. So it is very interesting. I think the most impressive thing is that every two consoles for a year that switch to energy saving, it saves the equivalent amount of carbon removed by one tree planted. That's awesome. Like,
yeah,
it only takes two consoles. So that is, I know most gamers won't care about this, but it is huge what they've been able to do in a powerhouse like Microsoft doing this. I'm like, I hope more companies look at this and go, oh, we could probably do something like that too.
Yeah. And like TVs and other things have optimizations like this too. But the difference, of course, is that like with Xbox and game consoles nowadays, their option of going in that sleep state rather than being turned off is meant to be, you know, as a bonus so that you can do all these things while you're offline, because gaming these days isn't as simple as just like plugging in a cartridge or putting in a disc. Like back then it didn't really matter. It was off. And like, you don't like, instead of just having like unplug it, like obviously the biggest way you can save is just unplug it.
Yeah.
But who's going to do that? It's too inconvenient. And you're like, Miranda,
plus you want your updates to be done when you play. Yeah.
Like, are you going to do that? Are you going to really unplug your Xbox? No, I'm not going to do that. But like, it is inconvenient. And I think Stella, as you're saying, and Taylor too, like them focusing on finding these ways that are more friendly to our wallets through the power grid, through energy saving, and obviously to the planet, and finding those small ways to keep advancing our technology, but also doing it in a responsible way that puts more of the responsibility on the companies making these devices rather than just the consumers. Because ultimately, yes, we have a lot we can do, but I'm also of the mind that the companies making all this stuff also need to be even more at the forefront of it. Like they need to be the ones changing their practices, changing their technology to make sure that they are developing things to be more responsible and making it easier for people who buy these things to do things better for the planet. And so I think that's what came down to it. And I was like, oh, well, if I want to be carbon aware, I could just unplug my console. And like, yeah, I'm not going to do that. So that was kind of the thing. And obviously there are a lot of buzzwords, anything you hear like carbon neutral or carbon whatever. Like I actually implore everybody to like look a little bit more into that. If you ever see something that's like, oh yeah, carbon neutral, I'll just do that. That's great. Like I remember I got some shipping from Etsy. It's like, this is a carbon neutral thing. And I was like, what? You didn't change anything.
Yeah.
Anyway, there's a lot of that buzz terminology and seeing a company like Microsoft, as you said, Taylor, too, join these initiatives and actually make changes that are substantial to the functions that they already programmed, made, and are shifting, and telling us how that works and why it works is really helpful and very, I think, friendly to us to understand why these changes are happening and how they actually benefit things. So, that's kind of the news for today. Like, I think there's not a lot else that we want to talk about, but thank you guys for joining me. And of course, we're not going to be doing any special Xbox trivia. Wait, what happened with trivia last week?
Oh, no one got anything. So it's basically like starting over.
Yay.
So,
okay. Because I think I know that one. And I was like, wait, I didn't have a chance to check it out. So I'll have to check. Taylor.
If I was on more, I would be slaying at trivia just because I'm really good at trivia. I do trivia every Thursday at this like speakeasy.
Oh, my God. Okay.
This is you're forbidden on the show.
Yeah, exactly.
You can only call an I host because I don't do the trivia. Because then you will just crush us all.
Yeah. That's,
oh, my goodness. Okay. Well, since we're skipping that for the week and I did not come up with a topic since we had so much news to talk about, I think we're going to go ahead and wrap it up. But first, Taylor, where can people find you and what are you working on?
You can find me on Twitter at Tay Nixter, and currently I'm just working on kind of like a curtain raiser for PlayStation VR 2. Please, Xbox guys, don't come after my neck. She asked me a question, I'm answering it honestly. So working on that since its releases next month. So I'm pretty excited about that. It's just kind of like a, oh, here's what I think is going to determine its measure of success. But that is, yeah, you can find me on Twitter at Tay Nixter. Yep. Or TikTok. I sometimes am on TikTok, but not really. Just mostly on Twitter these days.
Nice. And Stella, how about you?
Yeah. So this week I covered the Valorant new season patch and also the Apex season update. It's the collection event patch notes because you can make custom matches now. So if you want to watch that, you can go ahead and watch that on our YouTube channel. And then I have an op-ed piece coming out on Monday about Apex Legends and the content drought that it suffers from. But yeah, other than that, I'm Parallax Stella on Twitter and on TikTok, where I've been uploading like my daily, every other day fitness vlogs. So if you want to keep up with me there, that is where you can find me.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to follow you on TikTok.
Me too. I was just like, oh, that new fitness on TikTok.
Stella, we're fellow gym rats here.
Yeah.
So.
Maybe me soon too. Who knows? Yay. Yeah, trying. Ooh. We're trying. Getting back into it. New year, new me.
Your new year's resolution?
No. I said no new year's resolutions. That's
I don't do them either.
It's too much stress.
That's right. Yeah, yes. I don't do them either. Yeah. I know. It's a lot of pressure to put on yourself.
Exactly, right? Mm-hmm. You can find me at Havoc Grows, and that's Havoc with a K, on Twitch, Twitter, and Instagram. Right now on Twitch, I'm playing Gears of War 2 with my twin sister because she's never played it. So we're playing through the whole series, and it's been a delight. Something's about to happen. We're going to start crying soon. I already cried because Carmine. But aside from that, if you guys are going to be playing some of the new games coming to Game Pass soon, which include Persona 4 Golden and Monster Hunter Rise, and you need a little help, we've got a lot of guides for those. So please check that out. And then other than that, I'll be here next week, and we will be back. Thank you so much, Taylor, Stella, and Dustin at the dentist. I hope it's all well. I hate dentist time, but I hope it's going well. And then, of course, for our super producer, Red, and for Ryan, who's also not here, thank you so much for joining us, and we will see you all next week. Bye.
Will you live as pawns or die as pirates?